The exposure triangle is the most fundamental concept of image capture, yet many people know little about it. That's because the electronics of our cameras are fairly good at guessing what things should look like. Most of the time, you can trust your camera. However, if you're at all serious about photography or video, you need to understand how both work and the trade-offs that come with each. Hang on to the end of this video because I'm going to explain the exposure triangle for video specifically, because it's a bit different for video than it is for photography. Hi, I'm Jim Costa. I'm a full-time working photographer, video producer, video editor, and technology pro. If you like what you see in this video, stick around to the end because I've got a couple of photography, video, filmmaking, and editing freebies, and even some training courses I'll tell you about that will definitely help improve your work and help grow your business through earned media exposure. And remember, I welcome all of your comments, questions, and more on all of my videos. Before I begin though, I should say that the idea for this video came from a question from one of my subscribers. The question was so good that it warranted its own video. I've done a previous video on the exposure triangle that person actually watched, but it was geared a bit more towards photography and not so much towards video specifically. So I hope this video clears up those differences. I'll link to the other video in the description below so you can watch it after watching this video and you can learn even more about the topic. Simply put, exposure is the amount of light your camera's digital sensor absorbs. Sometimes you want this to be a lot of light and sometimes very little. For instance, you want lots of light on a beach scene at noon, but not very much light in a spooky parking garage at midnight. If you get the exposure wrong, your beach scene will look like you're seeing it through a welder's mask, while your parking garage won't be spooky at all because it'll look like you shot it in the middle of the day. There are three things that determine your exposure: your camera's shutter speed, its aperture, and the sensor sensitivity. Sensitivity is measured in either ISO, ASA, or gain, depending upon the camera. They all call it something different, but it means the same thing. Each of these variables has a gremlin riding on its back. That is, it changes something other than your exposure. Consequently, many people throw their hands in the air and set their camera to auto and then be done with it. There are several ways to arrive at the correct exposure. There are three points of the exposure triangle. Unfortunately, changing one setting of the exposure triangle means that at least one of the other two may need to be changed as well, all the while keeping in mind the side effects that go along with each of the three variables. What's more, when some numbers get bigger, things get darker, but when other numbers get bigger, things get brighter. So here's a quick look at what's going on with each variable. Shutter speed. This is the fraction of a second the sensor is exposed to light. As the numbers get bigger, the exposure gets darker. Aperture. This is the width of the diaphragm letting light in through the lens to hit the sensor. As numbers get bigger, the exposure gets darker because the aperture is actually getting smaller. ISO, ASA, or gain. Remember, they all have different names on different cameras, but are in fact the same thing. This is the sensitivity of the sensor to light. As numbers get bigger, the exposure gets brighter. Now, don't confuse shutter speed with frame rate because they're different things. When shooting video, your camera is recording a certain number of frames per second. This is usually 24, 25, 30, 50, or 60 frames per second. Those are the most common ones and depends upon how you're shooting and what country you're from. Technically, each of these frames is a still image, and shown one after the other, they look like they're moving. It's a common mistake to confuse how many frames are being shown each second with shutter speed. Shutter speed is simply how long the aperture is open whenever it captures a frame. Shooting at 1/125th of a second doesn't mean you're shooting 125 frames per second. You're still shooting 30 frames per second or whatever you chose, but each frame represents 1/125th of a second of exposure to light. Now, there's one other thing to consider that's not part of the exposure triangle where video is concerned, and those are neutral density filters. If you're shooting stills and you want a wide f-stop like f1.8, you can pick a high shutter speed to make sure your exposure is correct. But if your subject is moving, a higher shutter speed might cause your video to jitter. So what can you do to stop that? You can either lower your ISO or lower your lighting. However, your ISO can only go so low, plus if you happen to be using natural light like you're shooting outside, you can't very well dim the sun. Well, technically you can, sort of. How? By using a neutral density filter. Because neutral density filters are basically sunglasses for your camera. They make everything a little bit darker by making it more difficult for light to get through. By adding neutral density filters, you can open your f-stop to get a shallower depth of field without increasing your shutter speed. Let me give you some quick exposure tips. For the most natural motion blur, keep your shutter speed at double the frame rate. Intuitively, if you're shooting 30 frames per second, which is common in the United States, this means that you should be shooting at 1/60th of a second. But if you're shooting at 24 frames per second, which is common for films, you would want to shoot at 1/50th, since 1/48th isn't an option. Cameras have a native ISO that they're optimized for, often about 160. Keeping your ISO as close as possible to this setting will give you the highest image quality. To see how far you can deviate from this setting, do some real-world tests and examine the footage critically. Larger sensors can usually shoot noise-free at higher ISOs than smaller ones, or crop sensors as they're known. Some of those cameras are fairly good even up to and beyond 1600. Focusing can be extremely tricky with very shallow depth of field. Consider using a viewfinder magnifier or external monitor when focus is critical. Also, plan your shoots carefully so that you can smoothly follow people and keep them in focus as they move. In Hollywood, there are people called focus pullers, and their job is simply to make sure that the camera is focused while the camera and/or the actors move. When your ISO is maxed out, your aperture is as wide as it can be, and your shutter speed is as low as it can go. Where can you go from there? The answer is simple. Instead of trying to capture more light that isn't there, you can actually add more light by using artificial lights. Do this by either using artificial lights or moving the action closer to better sources of natural light that might exist, say close to a window or under a street light or something like that. In conclusion, learning how the exposure triangle works is one of the most important things to understand about video production. Luckily, there are only three numbers involved. What you need to do to be successful is to practice your exposure manually using all three of the variables listed. First, set your ISO low, and then come up with a proper exposure by changing the aperture and the shutter speed. Then set your ISO high, and again use the aperture and shutter speed to find the proper exposure. Finally, try keeping your shutter speed the same and arrive at the proper exposure using the aperture and the ISO. Remember, if things are too bright, you can add a neutral density filter to your camera to bring the brightness down. And if they're too dark, you can always add more light or check to make sure that you don't have a neutral density filter on your camera. Now, if this is making sense to you, but I've got it in the comment section below. My question of the day is, which aspect of the exposure triangle do you need the most help with? Leave a comment below and let us know, and I'll do my best to try and solve the problem for you. If you found that the information in this video was useful, I'd love to hear about it from you. If you liked it and want to see more videos like this, then follow my YouTube channel, Jim Costa Films. If you think what you saw was great, please do like it. If you have an opinion, then feel free to comment below. If you know someone who could benefit from the info that I provided, please share the video. You can connect with me and my company, Jim Costa Films, on social media and online on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, YouTube, LinkedIn, and the web by searching for Jim Costa Films. They're all named the same. In fact, I currently have over 4,400 videos on my YouTube channel, Jim Costa Films, so feel free to check out many of my other videos for great tips and suggestions. Thank you for sticking around this far. I mentioned at the beginning about some freebies and training. As a professional video producer and photographer, I've created an absolutely free cheat sheet for you on all the best settings to shoot video with your DSLR, mirrorless, and video camera that will show you the settings that will allow your photos, but particularly your videos, to shine and stand out from the competition. The link to get that cheat sheet is just below in the video description. Best of all, my cheat sheet specializes in shooting video with any type of camera. In it, you'll find all of the info you need on important video techniques, such as white balance, color temperature, frame rates, and more. I've also created an editing training for Adobe Premiere Pro. My Quick Start training is designed to get you up and editing video in under 2 hours, and includes more than 100 tips, tricks, and keyboard shortcuts designed for video editors. Best of all, the shortcuts that I include work on both Mac or PC, so it doesn't matter what you edit with. Now, I'm also affiliated with Christina Nicholson, a fellow media veteran like myself, who helps businesses and entrepreneurs reach tons of their ideal customers or clients through the power of media without spending big bucks on advertising. I've worked with Christina and used her advice and training very successfully, so I know from firsthand experience that it works great. The program that Christina and I are offering is called the Media Mentoring Program, and it'll help you take advantage of mainstream media so you can stand out from the competition, because that's not something that everyone actually has access to. Best of all, unlike paid ads and sponsorships, you can gain lots of exposure and credibility to become the go-to brand everyone talks about and wants to do business with without spending a fortune on advertising. I'll link to those cheat sheets and training courses in the description below as well. There's videos on both courses that will give you an overview of how they can help you and links to other online information. Finally, if you follow me for a while now, you may know that I have a private community of photographers, videographers, and filmmakers just like you on Facebook, where I share other pro tips and tricks. It's called Video Producers and Content Creators. It's a private group specifically for people in the photo, video, and filmmaking professions, and not a public group like my business webpage. I love new members who want to share their work, learn from others, and also help others based on their own skills and experience. You'll find the link to that group in the description below, so feel free to join the group where you can learn even more.